If we believe the ancient writings and prophecy, then everything we see in this seemingly infinite cosmos is merely a tiny quantum of divine energy, which angel beings once took into the depths by separation from God. From this formed cosmoses, solar systems and worlds, beings and human beings. If this is so, then matter would be merely a reflection of the pure being. How indescribably beautiful the heavenly worlds must be, if even the reflections are so wonderful. Our Earth is part of a solar system embedded in a huge spiral nebula in which each planet is in a certain interaction with the Earth. Majestic mountain ranges tower up into the heavens, touch clouds, and store valuable drinking water in their glaciers. They developed through tremendous primordial forces in the bowels of the Earth, where one continental plate pushed under another, and thus huge mountain massifs piled up, which, pushed by these immense forces, still continue to grow. Rivers and brooks are like the life arteries of our planet. They supply whole parts of the Earth with life-giving water. The whole water supply of our planet is a balanced system, a huge network which interacts, thus making life on this planet possible. Oceans, lakes, glaciers, and rivers are large reservoirs which give off moisture through solar radiation. Clouds form and in turn release their fertile rain in other regions. With the flowing rainwater draining off and collecting in brooks and rivers, some of which plunge into the valley in impressive waterfalls and again flow into lakes and oceans, the cycle closes. At the same time, this sensitive ecosystem is a gigantic filter system for the Earth. It is the kidneys of our planet, so to speak, which cleanse the water of pollutions and poisons. Elements like wind and water have been shaping the Earth's landscapes for millennia. Impressive rock formations and canyons developed through this that fascinate the viewer. As if shaped by the hand of a mighty sculptor, the elements formed these rocks into unique beauty. They present themselves as works of art permeated with light in expressive gradations of color. beautiful and to a part tremendous formations and fanciful structures, which developed through penetrating seepage water, are called dripstone caves. Over millions of years, continuous drops of lime-rich water formed these delicate structures of imposing size. Early man lived partially in caves and also used these for a pictorial depiction of their environment. Cave paintings have been found in hundreds of these caves, which were done 10,000 to even 40,000 years ago, during a climate period in which large parts of Europe were covered with glaciers. At first, science did not believe that the paintings could be so old, because they still imagined early man rather as lower primates that were capable of neither highly spiritual nor artistic achievements. What will still bear witness of our culture in 40,000 years? What will survive the time? What will our descendants be likely to find in caves? Huge amounts of highly radioactive waste. Perhaps then it will be said, no way they could have been intelligent people. The planet Earth, as it was originally given to mankind, was also a paradise for animals. This diversity and abundance of creation can still be seen today, among others in the endless vastness of the African savanna, with its huge herds of wild animals. The family groups of elephants are an impressive example of distinctive social behavior in animals. The oldest animal, the matriarch, leads her family always on the same paths to feeding grounds and watering places. The elephant mothers form a herd with their calves. Elephants communicate with one another, also using their feet. Researchers have determined that 90% of elephant communication takes place via seismic signals in low ranges, inaudible to man. Via so-called rumble tones, the female elephants coordinate matters within the herd. But they can also emit to elephants up to 10 kilometers away and communicate with them. This explains what was formerly a puzzle to scientists. Why elephant herds in various regions set out for longer journeys at the same time, seemingly on the spur of the moment and without external reasons? There is a great diversity of blossoming life in the plant world. The symbiosis of flowering plants with many insects is an important prerequisite for developing fruits and seeds of the respective species. At the same time, the plants give their helpers their valuable nectar. Until today, there are 180,000 species of butterflies known worldwide, and every year, about 700 new ones are discovered. Their diversity is directly dependent on certain plant species, which often occur in rainforests or nature reserves. The pollination of plants via insects is very important, above all the work of honeybees. If the honeybees die out, and there are signs indicating this, then mankind has a big problem. Then approximately one-third of our most important species of crop plants, like apples, oranges, beans, onions, and many other kinds of fruit and vegetables, would die out, or the harvests would be very meager, because they are all primarily fertilized by bees. Even many other pollinators, like bumblebees, butterflies, or flies, could not fill these gaps. Mankind's food would be endangered. Our planet consists of 70% water, just like the human body. Enormous oceans cover large surfaces of the Earth. Over the course of hundreds of millions of years, a fascinating underwater world has developed that shows itself to the viewer in a fullness of life forms. These underwater gardens are the home of a diversity of living beings whose fancifulness in color and form seem to have no limits. What many do not know is that the blooming coral gardens are not plant species, but animal forms of life, which feed on plankton. They are also a barometer for the climate change, because they react very sensitively to pollution and fluctuations in temperature. Many coral species live in symbiosis with certain fish. For example, we know the clownfish and their home in the sea anemones. Through their big, fan-like breast fins with long, almost freestanding barbs and their special coloring, the firefish are perfectly camouflaged between the various coral plants. Firefish are found in the coral reefs of the tropical oceans of Southeast Asia and the Red Sea. Firefish present a fascinating appearance. Nevertheless, divers respect them and keep their distance because they have a poison in their fins, which they use, however, only to defend themselves when attacked or crowded. The jawfish is also called a well driller due to its perpendicular houses in the sea floor. It lives in shallow water, mostly not deeper than 30 meters, on open sand or gravel ground, on which it builds its perpendicular entryways. The inner walls and entryways of the caves are reinforced with the help of stones, pieces of coral, or mussel shells. It is often busy all day long, excavating in order to enlarge its home, or to collect the right pieces of coral and then fit them into the right places. The houses are left only for short distances to feed or to defend their territory. When danger threatens, they disappear, tail first, into their den. As species-rich as the underwater world is, the most species-rich ecosystem is the green lungs of the planet, the rainforest. In this perpetually damp world of lianas, mosses, ferns, orchids, and old giant rainforest trees, live millions of colorful butterflies and other insects. The rainforest also provides a home for extraordinary animals like the sloth and the coati, the tiger, and many kinds of apes. This evergreen belt goes round the earth in the equatorial region from Southeast Asia over Africa all the way to Amazonia. Over 2,000 liters of annual precipitation per square meter and high temperatures lead to extensive growth. Even though only 7% of dry land is covered by tropical rainforests, up to 90% of all known animal and plant species are found in them, and it is estimated that there may be 20 to 30 million, of which only 1.8 million are known up to now. According to prophetic writings, creation is a reflection of the heavenly worlds and should remind us of our origin. But what is man turning the earth into? What is he doing with the wonderful landscapes? What is he doing to nature and the plant world? What is he doing to his fellow creatures, the animals? The earth is 4.6 billion years old. When we compare this period of time with one single day, then according to present-day science, human life on this planet has existed for just 3 seconds. And only since a hundredth of a second has the human race acted destructively against the Mother Earth. But during this hundredth of a second, man has damaged the planet so permanently that already in the foreseeable future, and above all for the coming generations, it will become a very great problem to live on this planet. Yes, to even survive. But when did this hundredth of a second begin? Let's look back a few thousand years. The sacrilege on nature started already at the time of the ancient Egyptians and Phoenicians. They used the noble and durable cedar wood from Lebanon, the queen of the plant kingdom, as it is also called, in large amounts for building ships and the pharaohs for their graves, palaces, and temple roofs. The result of this overexploitation is that only very few wooded islands with these world-famous cedars still exist in Lebanon today. One of these remaining wooded islands consists of 375 cedars, of which 4 trees have survived that are said to be over 1,000 years old. The circumference of these tree trunks measures up to 14 meters. At that time, God warned through his prophet Habakkuk by having him announce, "The violence done to Lebanon will overwhelm you. The destruction of the beasts will terrify you," to be read in the Old Testament. Other nations, above all the Greeks and Romans, deforested the entire Mediterranean region in order to build their fleets of merchant and warships. Entire islands were completely deforested. So today the macchia or shrubland prevails from Slovenia over central and southern Italy all the way to Portugal. 3 to 5-meter-high copse woods consisting of gorse, heather, and other shrubs is called macchia. The tall-growing holm oaks, which formerly characterized this region, have shrunk to tiny wooded islands. Today hardly imaginable, but the Spanish peninsula was once densely forested up to 95%. A squirrel can hop from the Pyrenees to Gibraltar without touching the ground, wrote the Greek geographer Strabon around the turn of the times. Today, the Mediterranean sun transforms every bit of cleared ground into powder dust. 60% of the land has already turned into steppes or is becoming karstified or desert. Through this, the climate changes, and there is less and less precipitation, which means even more hot periods. One result of this are huge forest fires, which in recent years have destroyed millions of hectares of the remaining forest. 1 hectare of forest would supply 10 to 20 tons of oxygen annually, store 4 million liters of water, and bind 30 to 35 tons of dust. And when for once there is sufficient precipitation, the soil is washed away and the swamps that should catch the water are thus quickly overfilled, so that large stretches of land are flooded. Tentative efforts at reforestation fail because fast-growing instead of native trees are planted, and so the hoped-for success is not achieved. Nature doesn't let itself be fooled. The process of land becoming steppes is not merely a Spanish problem. It is being observed worldwide. From outer space, one can observe well how the deserts are gaining ground. What has Homo sapiens learned from this? Today, it is above all the tropical rainforests around the globe that are going up in smoke and flames because of ruthless slash and burn clearance for profitable monocultures. Thus, the remaining rainforests, which are the lungs of the earth and supply a large part of the oxygen, also for human beings, are being irreversibly destroyed. The disaster for countless plant and animal species is not only blamed on man's greed for profit, but to a considerable part on worldwide factory farming. The cleared forest areas are used only a few years for growing feed for the slaughter cattle in the prosperous countries, until this soil too is depleted and turns into steppes. This is why the consumption of meat is also one of the greatest dangers for the world's climate. There are many examples of the ruthless behavior of man toward nature and the animals, and not only in the present time. Tortoises are undemanding animals. They can survive for months without food and water. Seafarers made use of this in brutal ways. They collected the giant tortoises, bound their feet together, and piled up hundreds of them on top of each other in the bilge of sailing ships. Here they suffered and vegetated without food or water for months until they were killed and eaten. Many species of giant tortoises were exterminated in this way. Still, other animals were also exterminated at that time. In the 16th century, approximately 30 million buffaloes lived in North America. No more than 30 have survived. 30 buffaloes from 30 million. How did this happen? The buffaloes in North America were shot down by the millions. For one thing, the desire to exterminate them was to take away the Indians' bases for food, and for another, leather was needed for the soldiers' boots. It became a popular sport to shoot down buffalo from a train with a rifle. In this way, one single rifleman could kill up to 100 buffaloes a day. It likely was the greatest massacre of wild animals that ever took place. It was similar for many whale species. 3 million whales were killed during the 20th century. In 1930 and 1931 alone, 30,000 blue whales were killed, exactly as many as still exist today worldwide. For example, sperm whales had to die because up to 1,500 liters of the coveted sperm oil is contained in their head. This enables the huge animals to dive into the depths of the ocean. People use the oil from the whales' heads as machine oil for cars and sewing machines, for instance. That's why they had to die. Here a quote from Arthur Schopenhauer fits very well. He wrote, "The assumption that animals are without rights and the illusion that our treatment of them has no moral significance is a positively outrageous example of Western crudity and barbarity. The animals are not a product for our use. They deserve from man not mercy, but justice." Let's take a further look into the time period of this hundredth of a second of a day on Earth, during which man began to act destructively against Mother Earth. It is the era of industrialization. Everything started quite harmlessly. The mechanical weaving loom was invented in 1784, and a mechanic invented the spinning machine. They made the weaver's work considerably easier, in order to satisfy the needs of a rapidly growing population. Thus, 100 times as much could be produced. At about the same time, the first usable steam machine was built, which became the basis for the Industrial Revolution. Machines of all kinds could be driven with it. Likewise, at the same time, the manufacture of crude iron began, and finally, also the production of steel. Connected with this was the mining of iron ore and coal to an ever greater extent. When at the beginning of the 19th century the steam machine served to propel locomotives and ships, commerce really began to flourish. The invention of the telegraph in the 1870s and later of the telephone and postal system considerably increased the rate of dissemination of news and thus the settlement of transactions. While the churches tended to support industrialization, already at the World Expo in 1851, there were many opponents. A social and green movement of intellectuals, writers, and environmentally conscious thinkers who perceived the progress of industry at the expense of nature as a very undesirable development. They criticized the ruthless striving for money and profit. But no one listened to this protest. It could no longer stop the course of events, which now took hold of the entire West. Industrial mass production developed very rapidly. In 1913, the first mass-produced auto rolled off the line. Soon followed the massive production of war equipment, such as tanks, airplanes, warships, and submarines. Also gigantic ships for civilian traffic, enormous tankers as well as consumer goods of all kinds. The new kind of mass production, in part also with robots, opened new possibilities for many branches of the economy. For example, a gigantic armament industry developed, which until today equips armies worldwide with deadly weapons and munitions. In several countries, weapon production has become an economic factor worth billions. Since capitalism is based on the principle of growth, many consumer goods are today designed to be thrown away after 2 to 3 years. This way, an artificial consumer carousel is kept alive, which turns ever faster so that the Earth's resources are exploited ever faster, thus allowing a so-called throwaway society to develop. The tremendous mountains of trash worldwide have become symbolic monuments of a superficial society with no culture. For this, huge wounds are made in Mother Earth in order to access the raw materials such as coal, copper, ore, uranium, petroleum, and not lastly, gemstones such as rubies, sapphires, diamonds, and precious metals such as gold and silver and much more. In recent years, pumping tons of chemicals deep into the earth has been done to gain petroleum and natural gas through so-called fracking. In the process, oil sand is brought from the depths to the surface in order to gain crude oil using a complex process that requires huge amounts of water. This controversial technique can have unimagined consequences for the environment. What is certain is that the groundwater is often contaminated. In several areas in Canada and USA, houses have already burned down because the water coming from the faucet was so mixed with gas that it caught fire. The German television program Spiegel TV reported on this phenomenon on April 16, 2012. The fact is that a current U.S. study found strongly increased amounts of methane in the drinking water in the vicinity of boreholes. Scientists from Duke University in North Carolina have proven that in 13 of 26 drinking water wells in a circumference of 1 kilometer from the shale gas boreholes are so strongly enriched with methane that the water could catch fire and, in part, blazed fiercely. There are considerations to use this fracking technology in Europe, even though a large part of the population does not condone this. Other projects are also promoted, disregarding the fact that a great part of the population rejects them. Just think of weapons purchases, weapons production and their exports, the subsidization and promotion of factory farming or genetically altered imports, and field trials. We can't help asking whose interests are at play here. Many say that we have to experiment so as to be able to preserve life on this earth, because man needs food, clothing, coal, electricity, oil, and many raw materials and other sources in order to make life as pleasant as possible. We need motors, airplanes, ships, vehicles, and much more to get around faster. We need medications and hospitals. We need houses to live in. We need factories to produce this and much more. But does man have the spiritual horizon to be able to correctly use and administer the gifts of this earth? For everything that cannot be brought into consonance with the natural laws will be man's undoing. Already today, this is becoming more and more apparent. Intellectual man plays and experiments with atoms and genes and with much more, without wanting to consider or recognize the consequences and risks. In this way, man raises himself above nature instead of acting in harmony with it. What further exacerbates the exploitation of the planet is the problem of rural migration into cities. Thus, mega cities with 20 to 30 million inhabitants have developed, such as New York, Tokyo, Mexico City, Manila, Mumbai, or Shanghai. In comparison, Switzerland has a mere 8 million inhabitants. These megacities consume enormous amounts of resources and energy. To produce this, hundreds of atomic power plants are operated all over the world, for which no solution has yet been found for their atomic waste that will radiate for thousands of generations. It is becoming more and more obvious that there is no solution. To gain energy from water power, rivers all over the world are dammed into large reservoirs with monumental dam walls. For this reason, people are often driven from their villages. But the earth is, or was, an organism that developed and balanced itself over billions of years. Such monumental shifting of weight not only influences the earth's magnetic field, the water masses dammed up behind the dams press on the Earth's crust with a tremendous weight of hundreds of millions of tons and can cause earthquakes because the Earth wants to relieve the tensions and reestablish the balance. Scientists are now raising alarm because the Earth is quaking ever more frequently in the vicinity of large storage reservoirs. In May 2008, a strong earthquake of 7.9 on the Richter scale shook the Chinese province of Sichuan. 70,000 people died. Until today, a further 18,000 are still listed as missing. Researchers assume the cause lies with the Zibpingpu Reservoir, which is only 5.5 kilometers away. Large cities also produce enormous amounts of refuse. For example, in Peking, over decades, a wall of dumps has developed around the city, many of them illegal. The groundwater is contaminated and the air polluted through countless fires. When windless weather conditions develop, big cities sometimes lie in an immense cloud of smog for days or even weeks. Many inhabitants suffer from serious respiratory diseases. Experts warn that death often comes with delay. With the invention of polyvinyl chloride, or PVC, mankind has picked up an additional trash problem, a hardly solvable one. The advantage of PVC is actually also its disadvantage, its durability. It doesn't decay, sunlight doesn't break it down, and air and salt water can do little or no damage to PVC. Thus, the oceans have in part become tremendous dumps filled with plastic. There are plastic trash vortexes in the oceans that have assumed unimaginable dimensions. The plastic breaks down into the tiniest parts that land in the stomachs of fish and birds, often leading to their demise. One of the most disastrous undertakings that man has perpetrated during this hundredth of a second of a world day is with certainty, for one, the manipulation of genes, and for another, the splitting of the smallest elements of creation, the atoms. Through genetic engineering, man has set a trap for himself that he can't get out of. Because when modified organisms are released, they can no longer be stopped from spreading. The results for man, nature, and animals are unforeseeable. Two large Japanese cities were destroyed and 130,000 people killed through the use of atomic bombs. The alleged peaceful use of atomic energy also bears, as is gradually becoming evident, unforeseeable risks. Until today, there is no solution for the many thousands of tons of atomic waste, which can still bring death to countless generations. When it is still claimed today that there is no special risk for the people who live near atomic power plants and the temporary and final storage places, the statistics speak an entirely different language. In addition, comes a danger that is underestimated until today. During the years between 1957 and 63, 8 countries carried out 2178 atomic bomb tests. The U.S. alone, 1146, the Soviet Union, 715, and France, 215. During these years, the atomic contamination rose higher than with the atomic disaster in Chernobyl. Meanwhile, the measurable levels in the air have returned to a minimum. But has the danger passed with this? Unfortunately not, for what has been underestimated until now is the long-term effects of nuclides, which went into the soil with the rain back then and are now gradually reaching the food chains of man and animal through the foodstuffs. The rising death rate of people that die of cancer has long puzzled scientists. Meanwhile, nearly every third man and every fifth woman dies of cancer in Germany. Worldwide, it's nearly a 500,000 people annually. New research has now brought the shocking results to light. The European Committee for Radiation Risk, in short, ECRR, consisting of 30 independent scientists, published a study in 2008 with numbers regarding the victims of the after effects of nuclear weapons tests. According to this, it is not, as previously assumed, 1.2 million people, but 61.7 million people who have died of cancer due to radioactive influences, including 1.5 million children and 1.9 million babies who already died in the womb. If these calculations are correct, then more people have already died as the result of the atomic bomb tests than were killed worldwide during the Second World War as civilians and soldiers. The scientists even assume that the release of radioisotopes into the environment through the civilian use of atomic power during recent years will soon cause a further increase in cancer and other diseases. During recent decades, it is also we human beings who have started to destroy the ozone layer, an extremely important protective layer for the Earth, by releasing into the sensitive balance of our atmosphere large amounts of chemical substances that destroy the ozone. Since then, ozone holes of more than 20 million square kilometers have formed over both poles, through which the more harmful ultraviolet radiation can penetrate. The size of the ozone holes fluctuates unforeseeably, and therefore we think that with a small ozone hole can't be all that bad. Thereby, we often forget that certain gases need 30 years to rise into these spheres, and we are now only experiencing the effects from 30 years ago. The danger should not be underestimated. Already today, ozone holes are damaging the plant world and triggering increased skin cancer in people. The latest research assumes that whenever the ozone content decreases 1%, the number of cases of skin cancer increases by about 5%. During the past 2,000 years, there have been many prophets and seers who warned mankind about the effects of its destructive activities against Mother Earth, and who beheld, to an extent, in amazing detail, the consequences of this wrong behavior in the future. They spoke of battles of nations and civil wars, of natural disasters, but also of the bad treatment of animals, which man would treat like a lump of clay, and also of the suffering of children and much more. Nearly 1,000 years ago, there were also warnings about the ozone hole, and it is even written that the air can no longer protect from the fire of the sun, and that the atmosphere would be merely like a curtain filled with holes, if mankind would not change its way of thinking and change its behavior. Several seers saw the ocean froth up like boiling water. Today we can puzzle about what is meant with this. Probably an increasing warming of the Earth's mantle from below, as was already observed in Greenland by scientists from the German Research Center for Geosciences in Potsdam. The scenario by several researchers that even cities and continents could disappear into the ocean was also already predicted as warning, and also that for this reason the people will flee to the heights. When we read these, to an extent, very old prophecies, we could think that we have the newest prognoses of the last climate conference in hand. While many hope that these prognoses and visions will never take place, for many scientists the point of no return has already been passed. Because through the massive pollution of the air with greenhouse gases, which trigger an increasing global warming, the global climate is changing and causing worldwide glaciers and polar ice caps to melt at a rapid pace, which will consequently lead to devastating natural disasters ever more often. During recent years, a large part of the glaciers in the region of Bhutan at the foot of the Himalaya has already melted. The same can be observed worldwide. The complete melting of the polar ice caps would cause the oceans to rise several meters, so that many countries and cities would disappear from the face of the earth. In addition, scientists are predicting unimaginably fierce storms that will occur ever more often, leaving no stone on top of another. The beginnings of this can already be seen in the USA. Weather anomalies will mix up the seasons so that it is warm in winter, for instance, and cold in summer, and can rain for weeks, which will lead to great floods. Much of this is already in progress to a certain extent. Industrialization did not stop before the animals either, and this is likely the most horrible crime of all committed by man during this hundredth of a second in a day in the world. Chicago was the precursor in terms of the industrial slaughter of animals on an assembly line. Already at the turn of the 19th century, 25,000 workers killed up to 12 million pigs and cows a year in its slaughterhouses. Thereby, they were proud to have attained a processing speed of 15 minutes from slaughtering a cow to packaging it into cans. The automated mass production of these slaughterhouses was considered exemplary throughout the world and was gradually copied in all countries, with the consequence that today 56 billion animals are killed annually worldwide. If the demand rises as up to now, it will soon be over 100 billion. In the process, the fact that animals are sentient beings with souls like we are is simply ignored, beings that need our special protection. Let's take a pig as an example. People cram it into the most confining, almost completely dark space by the thousands, so that it can hardly move or even not move at all. Without soft bedding, kept on cement-split flooring, often with infected feet and lying in its own excrement, to finally be driven into the slaughterhouse with electric shocks. The fact that a pig is one of the most intelligent mammals and is just as clever as a 3-year-old child or a dog is repressed. It is extremely clean and would, if it could, never lie in its own excrements. At the Leibniz Institute for Farm Animal Biology in Dummersdorf, Germany, Sandra Dupjan carried out intelligence tests with pigs. In one test, she gave each individual pig a rather complicated 3-syllable name, such as Brunhilde, Griselda, or Edelgard, and at feeding time called him via a loudspeaker by name. Already after just a short time, this worked perfectly. 40 pigs stayed lying peacefully, even though the food was ready, and patiently waited until they were called by name, to then run to the feed automats with a lightning start. What discipline! The owner of a domestic pig had a special experience in allowing it to live in her apartment like a dog. She registered the meanings of countless various sounds that she gradually understood. She said, "Actually, the pig communicates. Yes, it speaks constantly. We just don't understand it." Farmers often know about this intelligence. A farmer in Switzerland put the deadbolt of the barn door extra low so that the pigs could independently open the barn door with their noses when they wanted to go out. Another farmer from Denmark even lets the animals work with him. With the help of a joystick, he lets them control the ventilation and temperature in the barn with their noses. Pigs even immediately recognize themselves in a mirror, as do, by the way, also elephants, dolphins, and primates. And when they discover food in the mirror, they don't run behind the mirror, but directly to the right place behind themselves. These capabilities correspond to that of a 3-year-old child, and in part far more. Nevertheless, pigs are slaughtered. Why? Because we don't understand their sounds, their language. In the Bible we find in Isaiah, He who slaughters an ox is like him who kills a man. Meanwhile, scientists confirm that the production of meat is considered one of the greatest climate killers. A vegetarian diet could change the worldwide climate toward the positive. How much does the well-being of our planet mean to man? Are we prepared and willing to change our habits?